All right, friends, class number two here in level two advanced selling strategy. I hope that you enjoyed our class on FBI profiling and hope you realize, you know, I'm a tongue-in-cheek, fun kind of guy. And if you take your job too seriously, quite honestly, this is going to become very stressful for you, okay? We've got to sort of poke fun at ourselves and make fun of ourselves in the sales business. All right, let me point you over to a couple of free resources once you're done with this video series that you can take advantage of every single month absolutely free of charge to you. So the website where you go is you go to 360adsales.com. So just 360adsales.com. There's three places I want to point out to you. First and foremost, every other month we do a 60-minute webinar sponsored by one of our sponsors, free of charge to you. Punch in your email address and watch a webinar. So we're always going to be talking about topics and strategies that are specific and important and relevant to those of you in the advertising sales business. Then the next thing to point out to you, spot number two, is our ad sales blog. So for example, if someone was to say to me, print is not trackable. It is, and there's an article about that. Say you've lost your passion for sales. Go to the blog, there's an article about that. So basically, we've been doing this for 15 years. There's a lot of articles to help you, absolutely free of charge to you. And then of course, the podcast button. Every month, myself, my esteemed guests, we get on the podcast and we talk about topics relevant today, in the moment. It's very real time, and it's called Ad Sales Nation. So you can find that over on iTunes, search for Ryan Dorn, search for Ad Sales Nation, subscribe to that, and I think you're gonna find it to be very, very beneficial. And then last but not least, over here on the right side of your screen, you're able to type in your email address. And every single month, I'm going to send you absolutely free information on how to improve your ad sales life. Okay? All right, there. Self-promotion over. Let's move on. All right, seven ways to sell digital, media, the web. Let's really focus in on digital though today, like a boss, okay? Action item number one, digital media drives the ROI of the total media buy. Did you download the study guide, by the way? Hope you did that. Digital media drives the ROI of the total media buy. It's kind of funny, somebody said to me a couple weeks ago, Ryan, that's a ROI is kind of a buzzword these days, isn't it? No, it's not. Return on investment is something that's been around since the beginning of time. When you bought a cow that didn't give you enough milk and you paid too much for the cow, you'd say, hey, I'm not getting much return on my investment. So if someone says to you ROI is a buzzword, it's kind of like, huh, doesn't make a lot of sense. All right, let's focus in once again on the number three, the rule of three. And you notice in the level one training and level two training, a lot of things I talk about are rules of three. So for example, with emails, three words in the subject line, three sentences max. This is the marketing rule of three. Major marketers know this. Most of your advertisers do not. Major marketers understand that they have to advertise in multiple ways on multiple days. Insignificant, untrained advertisers will think they can run one ad and it's going to revolutionize their business. That means that they're insignificant, uninformed, they just don't get it. Major marketers, those of significance, those that have been doing marketing for a while, recognize marketing is not a one and done proposition. You have to advertise in multiple ways on multiple days. Now, when it comes to digital and digital advertising, it's important to recognize there's a lot of professional marketers out there. The joke that I often tell, and I just shared this joke with some friends this morning, you can walk into any coffee shop in America, any bar in America, and throw a cotton ball, and you're gonna hit somebody that thinks that they're a digital marketing expert. So you've gotta ask yourself, what do serious marketers do to maximize their return on investment? And here's what they do. They understand the marketing rule of three, and you're gonna have to explain this to your advertisers if you're gonna wanna sell more digital to them. The marketing rule of three simply looks like this. Number one, pre-promotion. That's pushing the rock up the hill. Pre-promotion is what's gonna drive excitement for the promotion or the product that they have coming out. Step number two of three, the actual promotion itself. That's gonna reward people that responded to the pre-promotion, that's gonna reward them with the actual promotion. This is where a lot of people stop, right here. They stop. They don't actually follow the rule of three. They don't do the last one, which is post-promotion. Post-promotion validates the campaign and inspires future purchases. Okay, let's start at the top again. Let me give you two examples. If you're dealing, I'm going to give you a local example, and I'm going to give you a B2B example. So a consumer example and a B2B example. All right, consumer example. We've all heard this one before. Pre-promotion. During the month, for example, of let's just say June, pre-promotion ad. Hi, I'm Crazy Ryan, and I've got cars. And on the 4th of July, we're selling cars. Come on down and play with the clowns. Ride the elephants and ponies. We're selling cars on the 4th of July. Okay, we've all heard it before, right? Okay, Crazy Ryan selling cars. All right, now when the 4th of July comes, that's pre-promotion. Driving excitement for what's coming up. Actual promotion. Hey, it's Crazy Ryan here, and today we're selling cars. Happy 4th of July, everybody. Come on down and play with the clowns, ride the elephants, pet the ponies, and buy a car. It's happening 4th of July sale today. Crazy Ryan's selling cars, okay? That's the actual promotion. Are you liking my ads so far? You digging them? Okay. All right, then Crazy Ryan doesn't end. Most marketers end right here. Crazy Ryan doesn't do that. What does Crazy Ryan do? We've still got cars. The 4th of July sale was an amazing success, but we've still got cars to move. Fortunately, the clowns are gone. Maybe we've got some leftover hot dogs and popcorn, but come on down. We're still selling cars. Why does Crazy Ryan do that? What does Crazy Ryan know, or what does Crazy Dave know that the rest of us don't? And that is, they understand the marketing rule of three. It's very, very simple. This is when you're pushing the rock up the hill. This is when you get the rock to the top of the hill. This is the power that comes when you shove that rock over the edge and it goes down to the bottom. Let me ask you this question. When a wave is building, is it most powerful as it builds, as it crests, or as it crashes? Always the third step. It's always more powerful when it crashes. When is a rock most powerful? When you're pushing it up the hill, when you get to the top, or when you shove it over the edge? When is it most powerful? It's most powerful on the other side. So if you want to sell more digital, you've got to walk your advertisers through the marketing rule of three. Let me give you a B2B example. Let's just say a company is going to be launching a brand new product to an industry in the month of February. In the month of January, they want to be running pre-promotional ads. Here's what we've got coming. That ad might say, an exciting new announcement from such and such a company. An exciting thing is coming from Acme Company. Then during the month when they launch the product, it says, here it is. Acme proudly presents blah, 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 blah. Then what a lot of marketers do is they end with number three. So they don't ride the wave. They don't take advantage of the power of the boulder that's rolling down the hill. This is when you validate people, you thank people, you inspire people. Now, it's also important for you to recognize this promotes acquisition and excitement. This is the actual acquisition strategy. Third and foremost, this is acquisition, but also retention. This is where retention activities take place. If you ask serious marketers from Mercedes-Benz and people like that, why do you run ads that really aren't necessarily selling anything? Is it just to promote the brand? A lot of times they run ads because they just want people that have spent the money on an expensive Mercedes-Benz to feel good about it. So that's why a lot of times people will run ads in your market or in your industry just thanking people for buying. Because when you thank people for buying, the likelihood of them coming back grows exponentially. Check this out. A lot of people don't realize this. You can Google it at salesdriver.com. People that are a current customer are 65% more likely to buy from you because they know you. They're a current customer. So for me, going out and trying to find brand new people doesn't make a lot of sense. I just need to keep the people I have happy. That's why the fifth class in this level two series is all about advertiser retention. Because if we can keep people around, boy, it's going to inspire future purchases. And that's an important piece. All right, so friends, maybe you did not learn this in college or wherever. This is the marketing rule of three. So if you're gonna sell digital like a boss, digital might be here. You might use an e-newsletter to pre-promote. You might use several print ads or a spread to really take it to the next level. That might be piece number two. Then you might use a banner ad campaign or a lead gen or a webinar, something like that from a digital perspective in this third phase of the process. See, one of the things a lot of you unfortunately do wrong is you try to sell everything all at once and you don't actually follow the rule of three to get more return on investment for your advertisers. Digital can be here, digital could be here, here. It can be a gentle mix of those things because not everybody has the budget to afford to be able to do it correctly. Let me set this out in plain terms. A lot of times we're pitching to people that have a very, very limited budget. So because of that, we need to help them make their marketing dollars go further. In our level one training, as we talked about hosting sales calls and the roadmap to follow, which you probably remember is that I like to present packages. Well, the nice thing about packages is it gives somebody a holistic approach to marketing. Some folks just can't afford it. So what I would do is I would sell them digital here, TV here, more digital here. Or I'd sell them a TV ad here, digital, and more TV. I can spread their dollars out as long as I'm following the marketing rule of three. Now, do I share this with advertisers, the marketing rule of three? I do. I talk with them about it all the time. And what I do is I show them just like this. I walk them through one, two, and three. I walk them through it, one, two, and three. And I use a visual. So you might have a one sheet that talks about the marketing rule of three. Remember, 3M said it best. You can increase by 60,000% comprehension and retention in using graphics in your sales presentation. But here's the big thing. I want you to say this with me. You have to advertise in multiple ways on multiple days. You want to be telling that to every advertiser. You'll know you've gotten the point across when they say it back to you, and that's a very important piece. Also, as a part of your sales mantra, I beseech you to say and help them understand, marketing is not a one and done proposition. If it was that easy, that's what Coca-Cola would do, okay? If it was that easy, you know, somebody like Budweiser would never buy an ad during the Super Bowl. It's just too expensive. Marketing is not a one and done proposition. Now, let's take a look at this graph, and I think it's an important piece for us to share. The reason you need to advertise in multiple ways on multiple days is because of the lift that you will get, Mr. or Mrs. Advertiser. All right, so from Millward Brown Digital, this is when the advertising campaign began. So someone is gonna see an ad one or two times. So brand awareness, it's there, but it's fairly low. Print ad awareness, just from print ads, it's there, just fairly low. How people feel about that brand, brand favorability, it's there, but at about 9%, okay? The purchase intent, this purple line is really the one to follow here, okay? Or that blue line, I guess, okay, is the one to follow here. It starts out at 10%. So when someone sees an ad one or two times, digital, print, radio, TV, newspaper, whatever, all of these different things, brand awareness, purchase intent, brand favorability, all of those things start out around a 7 to 10 percentile mark. Now, when someone sees the ad 3 to 4 times, it actually grows. Brand awareness grows from 7 to 10%. Print ad awareness grows from 8 to 11%. Brand favorability, holy cow, jumps from 9% to 14%. So when someone sees an ad 3 to 4 times, all of a sudden how they feel about your brand, Mr. or Mrs. Advertiser, jumps pretty dramatically. But this purple line, that bluish purple line, you know, that jumps from 10 to 13%. But now watch what happens. This is amazing. When someone sees an ad 5 or more times, look what happens. All of a sudden, purchase intent jumps to 18, almost 20%. Now, here's the thing that's interesting. We all know this. We all know that when someone sees your ad in multiple ways on multiple days, they're more likely to purchase your product. It's just logical. But the simple fact is, advertisers have been fighting us for years. They deny that simple truth. And the simple truth is, It starts with an F, ends with a Y, frequency. Advertisers want to deny that frequency exists and that it works. Instead, what they want to do is run one ad and they want the world to change. It just doesn't work that way. If it worked that way, that's what Michelin tires would do. That's what Pampers would do. That's what these major companies would do. They recognize that if they want to drive purchase intent, brand favorability, overall awareness, awareness of the brand, they need to have multiple exposures. So for me, this might be something you can download these slides, look up this Millward Brown digital study. Digital drives purchase intent. It drives total ROI for your total marketing program. All right, action item number two, print and digital, or be, if you're selling TV is fine as well, traditional and digital complement each other. So don't get lost here just because it says print. Traditional media and digital complement each other to drive return on investment. All right, let's take a look at this chart. So the first grouping here is brand awareness. Second grouping here is brand favorability. Third grouping here is brand purchase intent. So we're gonna focus on here, TV, online, and then print media. All right, from a brand awareness perspective, if all you do is digital, that's it, it's gonna be okay. But when you add TV to the mix, brand awareness jumps 5%. When you add online to the mix, to the total media mix, it's gonna jump, your brand awareness is gonna jump by 4%. If you add print media to the mix, it's actually gonna jump by as much as 8% brand awareness. You can see the source here. This is magazines.org/factbook. So specifically, if you're in the print business, this is gonna be very beneficial. But hey, look what happens with TV. TV is driving 5% and print is driving 8%. It's pretty darn close, it's pretty good. All right, brand favorability, how people, consumers, feel about your brand, okay? What's gonna happen here, this is TV. TV is gonna drive brand favorability by 8%. By adding TV to your media mix, it's gonna drive brand favorability by 8%. Print media, the big purple line, it's gonna drive brand favorability by as much as 11%. Now, digital's here, this is online at 4%. It's not that it doesn't work, it's not that it's not important, it's not that it shouldn't be a part, it should. It's just not gonna drive it as much as some of the other medias in terms of brand favorability. All right, brand purchase intent, someone wanting to purchase. Print is the big winner here. By running a lot more print ads, you're driving a lot more purchase intent. It's probably because of the pace at which people read newspapers and people read magazines. So if you're reading an article in a magazine, okay, you're going at it at a slower pace than if you're listening to a radio ad or watching a TV ad. There's nothing wrong with those medias. I love those medias. You just have to absorb them faster and you have to calculate them faster. Also recognize with TV, with radio, and I love them. I love those brands, those types of media. You are actually someone else is controlling the interaction. And that's very, very important. You're driving down the road, you're listening to a radio ad, somebody else is controlling that. Now you can change the channel, but someone else is controlling when you hear it, how long you hear it. You're watching your favorite TV show on CBS or whatever, and someone else is controlling the commercials, when they play, how long they play, and things like that. With magazine media and newspaper media, digital media, it's a little bit different. You control how fast you read articles. You control where you read them. Are you at the kitchen table? Are you in the bathroom? Are you on the bus, in a boat, at the beach? Where are you? It's a lot of bees, by the way. I mean, you control that situation, newspaper and magazines. All right, so brand purchase intent. Here is TV. TV is 8%. It's gonna increase the purchase intent by as much as 8%. So TV does really well. It's not that online doesn't work. It just drives double with television and almost a little more than double with magazines, with traditional media, print. So I just wanna be clear on that. Love digital, digital is a part of the overall mix. Here's the interesting piece. You combine the three of these, that's what drives return on investment. So you've got basically 10, 10, and 5. So if you wanna drive as much as 25% of purchase intent, this is what happens. Digital is gonna add a lift. It's gonna add a lift to the overall campaign. Okay, now here's a graph, a stat that I really want you to pay attention to. We've been waiting for this information for years. Are you familiar with the Nielsen company? Okay, Nielsen does TV ratings. Nielsen is an industry-wide recognized household name. If you ask, and how I know this is I'll ask like my mom. I'll say, hey, have you ever heard of Nielsen TV ratings? Oh, of course. They've heard about them for years. Here's what we're seeing, and I want you to pay attention to this. This along the bottom is frequency. Okay, this is the number of exposures of an ad to a consumer. So one exposure all the way up to 10 exposures, okay? Over here is the average lift in resonance of the ad, okay, of the ad. So with one exposure, what you're seeing is you're seeing a lift of about, 5% or so. The second exposure, you're seeing a lift, 7 to 12%, or so. Now recognize this top line is awareness, how someone feels if they're aware of the ad. The bottom line is their purchase intent. So by seeing an ad, the first time they see it, they sort of want to purchase it and they're sort of aware of it, but not much. Okay, it goes from 5% to 7 to 10%, then it jumps to 11, 12%, then it jumps to 13, 14, 15. When you get over here to 8 exposures, look what happens. All of a sudden their purchase intent and their awareness jumps 15 to 20%. But here, my friends, is the hockey stick moment. This is when you go boom, boom. So this is the bottom of the hockey stick. This is the stick itself, okay? When someone gets to 9 and 10 exposures, look what happens to the awareness. It jumps to 30%. So what does this tell us to our advertisers? It tells us, number one, that our advertisers are wrong. They think they can run one ad and it's gonna make all the difference in the world. It's just what's gonna happen is you gotta get to at least 10 exposures to a particular ad before someone goes, aha, I need to purchase that product. So this is Nielsen telling us that we have been right all along. Now you've gotta be careful. Let's go back to our personality profiles. We've gotta be careful. Does Relationship Renee care about this? Not really. How about Analytical Al? Does Analytical Al want to see this? Oh yeah, absolutely. All right, how about Decisive Danielle? Maybe, but be careful about doses of reality. Okay, how about Innovative Irene? Does she want to see this? No. All right, how about Skeptical Steve? Maybe. Maybe. It really just kind of depends upon the circumstance and situation. I would probably say that Skeptical Steve would probably respond positively to this because it came from Nielsen. Does that make sense? Now, you want to be careful if you're dealing with Relationship Renee or you're dealing with Collaborative Claire and you start pulling out stats, facts, and figures, it may or may not work. You want to be really, really careful about that. Okay, let's take a quick break. That's a lot of information to absorb. If you're watching this with a group, press pause on the video before you go on to part number two. I want you to discuss these graphs. Here's my promise to you. If you have questions about these videos, drop me an email, ryan@ryandorn.com. ryan@ryandorn.com. My last name is D-O-H-R-N. If you got a question about these, send me an email. Happy to answer those questions. Download these slides. Use them as your own. Use them in sales presentations. But friends, recognize you only want to present stats, facts, and figures to personality profiles that are going to accept them and will aid in the overall decision. All right, friends, we'll be back in two with the second part of this class on selling digital like a boss.